I'll introduce our speaker. Now, once we had planned to sponsor this lecture, the question was, well, who do we invite? So I went to a couple of our African-American literary specialists, and I asked them, well, you know, who would you want to invite? And Brian Roberts, especially, helped put together a very small list of people we really most want to meet. And right at the top of the list was Jacqueline Goldsby. Well, we'll give it a shot, see if we can get Professor Goldsby to come visit us. We were very fortunate that she said yes. And so it's a great pleasure to introduce her to you. Just a few highlights so you know who she is. She earned her PhD at Yale in 1999. Is that right, Jackie?
Mm-hmm.
And after a brief stint at Cornell, she spent the next 10 or so years working at the University of Chicago, where she was an assistant, then an associate professor of English. Is it African American Studies? Just English. While at Chicago, she spearheaded this terrific archival project, began, I believe it called Mapping the Stacks. And this project assembled and made accessible a wealth of mid-20th century material related to African-American history in Chicago. It's a tremendous project. And while she was at Chicago, she also published her first book, a wonderful book, entitled A Spectacular Secret, and subtitled Lynching in American Life and Literature. It was published in 2006 by the University of Chicago Press. And this book, I mean, I really recommend it to you very highly. It combines a history of lynching in America, a grim subject, but a very important subject to know about, by telling a variety of sort of historical narratives about this subject. And then it attaches this history that it tells to an analysis of what Professor Goldsby calls the cultural logic of lynching. And this is where the book gets really, I think, multidimensional in the way it approaches the subject. This is a cultural logic that is not reducible to the racist attitudes of just a small segment of the American population, nor is this logic reducible to the anxieties or the nostalgia or the anger of the South at the Civil War. Instead, this logic really inflects institutional, economic, and affective structures of modernization in America. And this makes the violence intrinsic to lynching both widespread, which is bad, but also, more fortunately, susceptible to thoroughgoing critique and potential change. It's an excellent book with, among other things, some very poignant readings by a number of prominent American authors. In her current work, Professor Goldsby is completing a Norton critical edition of James Weldon Johnson's classic autobiography of an ex-colored man. It's a 1912 novel that Professor Goldsby interprets as a harbinger of Afro-Anglo-American modernism. And that modernism is a subject of a book, a major book she's now writing, tentatively entitled The Birth of Cool, which I think is a cool title. And a part of that book, I believe, is the subject of our talk today. And that title is The Art of Being Difficult, The Turn to Abstraction in African-American Poetry and Painting in the 1940s and 1950s. Now, on a personal note, last thing I'll say, it's been a tremendous pleasure for me, a real privilege, to spend some time with Jackie yesterday and then again today. She's a wonderful guest, very interesting. And you're going to find this to be a great lecture, I'm sure. So with no further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Jacqueline Goldsby.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
That'll be great.
Okay. Good afternoon. It is afternoon, right? I'm on sabbatical, and I am spending it my time in Seattle, and so I'm still getting adjusted to literally to time, because it's probably 3 o'clock in New Haven, it's 12 o'clock in Seattle, and it's 1 o'clock here, so I have to check myself often. Matt, thank you so much for that very generous introduction, and thank you for inviting me here. This is really an important moment for me because I'm on sabbatical and because I'm about to dive into the cave of writing, It's very important to be in contact with people and to talk about our ideas in public and to hear questions and to hear provocations. And so I want to thank the Center for Humanities for inviting me here today, the Department of English, and the college itself, the university itself, for having me. I'm really honored to be here. And thanks for taking your time on a Friday afternoon to be here. A couple more words about where this work is coming from, and then I'll get into it. As Matt mentioned, I am at work on this project I'm calling Birth of the Cool, and it's actually a trilogy. Moving from the late 19th, early 20th century of American and African-American literary culture to the mid-20th century has been a huge leap for me. And the best way that I felt I could come at this period, which roughly bands between 1947 or so for me to about 1965, was to think about a series of three books that would allow me to ask the kinds of questions that I feel emerge from the literature itself and that characterize this period. And there are three central questions that for me make the mid-20th century era of African-American writing so vital and yet so overlooked. I don't understand why we've not, as scholars, taken up this period more assiduously as we could. But what's striking about it to me, and I hope that the work I'm going to talk about today gives you a feel for that, is that the aesthetic confidence and complexity of this literature is just unparalleled. I mean, these are the years when, maybe to attach it to some names that you know, Ralph Ellison, James Baldwin, Richard Wright are producing their works, but there's a whole host of other writers who I'll talk about in my talk today, so I won't mention them now, who are working with a kind of presence and assurance about the work that literature can do in the world that's just unmatched to, I think, what Black writing is doing now in our present day. And even to the Harlem Renaissance. I'll go out on that limb and say that, and Brian, you can push back on me if you like in Q&A. But in the 40s and 50s, Black writers find a voice that's powerful and distinct and confident. I call it cosmopolitan, and I'll talk about that more in the paper today. But that interests me. That interests me. And it also interests me that this confidence, this complexity, seems to come out of a new place on the literary map, and that's Chicago. It's not that New York and Harlem cease to be important, but Chicago becomes the place where, if you're a Black artist of any note, whether it's in music, visual arts, or literature, at some point you're thinking about Chicago. Langston Hughes spends an enormous amount of time in Chicago, physically on the ground, writing for the Chicago Defender. The coterie of Black visual artists and poets, novelists, dramatists that emerge from Chicago itself, it's extraordinary who comes out of there. Gwendolyn Brooks, who I'll talk about more today, Margaret Walker, Lorraine Hansberry before she left for New York, Frank Marshall Davis, Frank Yerby, William Attaway, Frank Marshall Davis, I might have mentioned, Marita Bonner. I could go on and on. It's really extraordinary. Frank London Brown. And all of these poets, novelists, dramatists are publishing with mainstream presses, and all of their books are selling to huge popular acclaim. So why Chicago? And why does this work become popular? That interests me. What about Chicago is fostering this? And the last kind of fillip of thread that I'm wanting to follow in this work is that I actually taught a course about the scene of Black writing in London during this time, the 1940s and 50s, because a comparable movement emerges there. And without a fault, in every novel that's published from 1948 to 65 by Black writers in London, out of London, I'm thinking of Sam Selvin's The Lonely Londoners, George Lamming's In the Castle of My Skin, even V.S. Naipaul's first novel, House from Mr. Biswas, there's always a writer figure who's either come back home to the West Indies, or if the novel is set in London, comes back to London from a stint in the United States where he's tried to make his go at being a writer. And guess where he tries to ply his craft? Chicago. So in the London literary imagination, Chicago is the place to be in the United States if you want to be a writer. Why is that the case? So that's what I'm wanting these books to figure out. And the work I'm going to share with you today is a first way I'm trying to crack into that by talking about what I call this turn to abstraction in the poetry and painting of the era. So just one second. Eagerly awaited upon its release, Gwendolyn Brooks' Annie Allen stymied book reviewers when it appeared in 1949. Brooks pulls a sonnet as a bowstring, a loaded bowstring at that, the New Yorker marveled. However, the magazine's critic dismissed the collection for its experimentalism in language, not all of which comes off. While the nation echoed this complaint, Brooks's diction seems to be carried away by the big word or the spectacular rhyme. The Saturday Review of Literature's editor refused to consider the collection at all. Done with his reviewer's copy, William Rose Benet tersely informed Brooks's publisher, Annie Allen doesn't seem to me to be up to Brooks's first book. More than anyone else, Brooks's editor at Harper Brothers was distressed by Annie Allen. A Street in Bronzeville sold a head-turning 3,000 copies when it debuted in 1945, confirming Elizabeth Lawrence's judgment that Brooks's career was worth Harper's investment. However, when Brooks's follow-up manuscript arrived 3 years later, the editor was sure her rising star had lost her way. In many of the new poems, the form, the mannerisms tend to intrude and obscure the content. There is a preciousness, an artificiality that is foreign to you as I know you. Wanting Brooks to return to the tough, direct simplicity that is so characteristic of your finest work, Lawrence urged Brooks to revive the style of A Street in Bronzeville, which was achieved through clear, decisive writing with the emphasis on content rather than form. Annie Allen, in contrast, was too intellectual, too modern. Those are Lawrence's words. The philosopher and intellectual leader of African American literary culture, Elaine Locke, was not a fan of Brooks's new work either. Still dispensing his taste-making power long after the Harlem Renaissance, Locke's annual book review essay for Phylon magazine in 1950 offered polite applause for Annie Allen's distinctly original and professionally competent poetry. Locke also expressed appreciation for the volume's striving to discover the universals and the particulars of a modern woman's experience with love, motherhood, struggle, frustration. But he spared no mercy naming the poem's faults as he saw them. Much remains turgid and over-anxious. One hopes Gwendolyn Brooks is en route to a style and idiom of her own. Given this disgruntled reception, it's remarkable that Annie Allen received the Pulitzer Prize in 1950. That said, there's no denying Annie Allen's experimental ambitions. These lines from the Anniad, the collection's central poem, describe the World War II battlefront as follows. Doomer though crescendo comes, prophesying hecatombs, surrealist and cynical, garrulous and guttural, spits upon the silver leaves, denigrates the dainty eaves dear dexterity achieves. This crush of words pounded out using irregularly cycled iambs and trochees sounds like Hephaestus at work in his smithy. Poetry is being forged before our very eyes as we read this passage. But what does it all mean? War brings doom, yes. Battle's destructiveness can be surrealist. The motives for war, certainly cynical. Garrulous or guttural. Why call war by those names? Confusions then only multiply. Who or what spits upon the silver leaves? And silver leaves, why not earth brown or blood red? If this is war, what kind of war is it? Annie Allen's formal opacities interest me immensely and are a focus of my talk today, not because they're anomalous in Brooks's career, but because the poem's supposed difficulties turn out to be quite common in African American literature's mid-20th century canon. For instance, amongst Brooks's verse writing peers, Russell Atkins spent the 1950s in Cleveland developing the psychovisual theories that inform his approach to concrete poetry, while Robert Hayden's Middle Passage, reworked four times between 1941 and 1962, and Melvin Tolson's libretto for the Republic of Liberia, which came out in 1953, reclaimed the epic mode to re-narrate the New World's founding through slavery. The hurdle Margaret Walker cleared when For My People won the Yale Younger Poets Prize in 1942 for its innovative turns with free verse, folk ballads, and the sonnet, Bob Kaufman trampled on as he helped organize the performance art happenings in San Francisco's North Beach that gave the Beat Generation its name. Experimentation led African-American prose writing during the 1940s and 50s in fresh directions as well. Examples that come easily to mind: Ralph Ellison and Adrian Kennedy's shared penchant for surrealism. Recall Sarah's deranged mental landscape and Funny House of a Negro, or The Invisible Man's drive to True Blood's shack. Anne Petrie's and James Baldwin's flair with time-space collapse. Here, I have in mind how the use of flashback sequences in the street in Giovanni's room defy linearity. Paul Marshall's probing of what we might call the Black diaspora's geographic unconscious. Brown Girl, Brown Stones dares us not to think of those stalwart walk-ups in Brooklyn as sites of the uncanny. Or Richard Wright's existentialist humanism, which extends from the man who lived underground in 1944 to the outsiders in 1953. All of these are amazingly complex, dense works. And if you've not read any of them, that's okay. Summer reading. But during the late 1940s to early 1960s, this work exemplifies how African-American literature turns away from the tenets of figural realism to develop a representational mode I call abstractionist. Resistant to mimetic verisimilitude, uninterested in affective transparency, and above all, self-conscious about the materiality of their form and making. These novels, dramas, and poems challenge the long-standing presumption that realist aesthetics best define the scope and subjects of Black fictive discourse. In my talk today, I'll read Annie Allen as a nodal text of this paradigm shift, gleaning from its publication in my gloss of its central poem, The Anniad, an account of when and why this turn to abstraction occurred, the stakes that motivated it, and the reason why this turn not only eluded Elizabeth Lawrence's and Elaine Locke's appreciation, but remains under-conceptualized in African-American and American literary histories of the period as well. Now, the turn to abstraction that I want to claim Annie Allen typifies is not wholly unfamiliar to us. Are there any jazz heads in the room? Jazz fans, maybe? Okay, so you all have this rich, wonderful history about jazz and bebop, right, as the sine qua non of African-American experimental art, and rightfully so. Indeed, jazz music's cadences, to recall Robert O'Malley's apt term, are so demonstrably ingrained into all of post-war American literary and visual culture that it seems conceptually impossible to define abstraction's logic and praxis in either the African-American or Euro-American canons without reference to it. We know that Jackson Pollock painted to jazz. We also know that, why am I spacing on her name right now? Oh my goodness, Patricia Alber's new biography of, not Helen Frankenthaler, who was the other major woman abstract expressionist? I can't believe I'm spacing on this. I'll remember in a minute. But she listened to Ornette Coleman, seriously. Anyway, so that's to say that everybody's drawing energy off of jazz. That's incontestable. But I want to put pressure on the idea that we should focus our attention there for two reasons. First, a comparably pronounced turn to abstraction reorients African-American painting during the 1940s and 50s, too. In these years, Charles Alston, Ramar Bearden, Beaufort Delaney, Ronald Joseph, Norman Lewis, Rose Piper, Thelma Johnson Street, Alma Thomas, and Hale Woodruff, all of them, abandoned their allegiance to social realism's emphasis on figural representation to adapt modernist geometrics, color field, and collage techniques as the foundations of their visual vocabularies. And I want to say here, I deliberately give you that roll call of names to mark how we need to think of this period in terms of cohorts. These are not people working by themselves, right? They're groups, clusters, thinking, working, producing together. While it's true that bebop's radical harmonics, atonalities, and breakneck time signatures advance non-figural representation in African-American literature and visual arts, jazz affected Black literature. That's true. Not arguing against that. But what histories and aesthetic theories become available to us if, for the sake of argument, we bracket music from the cultural field? If we don't privilege the sonic at the expense of the visual, As Sarah Blair aptly frames this methodological choice in Harlem Crossroads, Black Writers in the Photograph in the 20th Century, a marvelous book. What does literature's interplay with the visual arts, does it provide us new categories of analysis to pursue? If so, what might those domains be? Thus, my second reason for bracketing jazz music out of my discussion is to align African-American poetry and painting shared interests in non-figural representation, to explore how we might conceptualize abstraction's cultural field as a post-World War II, pre-civil rights movement phenomenon more broadly. By raising medium-specific questions about poetry and painting's aesthetic logics, which I'll pursue by reading Annie Allen together with the paintings of Norman Lewis, whose turn to abstraction is as sharply drawn and well-archived like Brooks's, I hope to define more precisely what abstraction is and does in African-American print and visual culture during the 1940s and 50s. Let's see how this works. Black screen for a moment. By the time I began to write Annie Allen, I was very impressed with the effectiveness of technique, and I wanted to write poetry that was honed to the last degree that it could be, Brooks explained to Studs Terkel in 1961. She may as well have been referring to the book itself, because Brooks paid so much attention to the honing of Annie Allen as a physical object that we might regard the book itself as a work of art too. Richly detailed in her letters to her Harper's editor, Brooks's design plans for the volume warrants close scrutiny because the material hermeneutics of the text, that is, the material qualities and provenance of the artifact as such, to cite Jerome McGann, bear suggestively upon what abstraction does and means in the poems themselves. If readers judge a book by its cover, the seemingly prosaic, almost dull typography and layout of Annie Allen's dust jacket belie the complex identity politics that beckon us into the world of the book. And here we're looking at a first edition with a dust jacket, and as Brian and I have talked about this before, it's very hard to find first editions with dust jackets. Very hard, not least because it was the policy of libraries until about the mid-1930s to destroy dust jackets, and it continues to be the case. And that's why books with dust jackets command such high prices on the rare book market. So just finding these books is a challenge. In this text-heavy scheme, our eye is drawn immediately to Annie Allen, since the font size of those words dominates the top half of the book's cover. The smaller floral insignia that catches the reader's attention too. A banal trope of the poetic, it signals the clear difference between the Brooks protagonist and its author. Brooks's name appears smaller than the title, as befits her role as artiste. A mature and distinctive craftswoman, as the blurb attests, Brooks can't possibly be confused with her more naive poetic subject. Upon opening the book's cover, though, the frontispiece throws the cover's distinctions of name and social rank into doubt. This sketch portrait of Brooks is untitled. Only the artist's signature, Ernest Alexander, and the drawing's date, March 9, 1949, are legible at the bottom right corner of the image. I've never done this before, so does this red, here. There's the artist's signature. There. These captions, which paradoxically cast the portrait sitter as an anonymous subject, pose a curious litmus test for the reader. Those in the know would know who they were looking at in the frontispiece, since a Street in Bronzeville success had made Brooks a national celebrity in 1945. Readers unfamiliar with Brooks's work might confuse the woman in the portrait with the poem's protagonist, Annie Allen, though, and in that way fall prey to the long-standing presumption that Black writing is always already autobiographical. Probing the reader's knowledge of Brooks's cultural authority as a poet, on the one hand, together with the reader's awareness of African-American literary traditions on the other, the frontispiece reminds readers how they make judgments about Black-authored texts, and in the case of Annie Allen, the Black women who are its literary source. Jarring readers' expectations about the relation between literature and history, poet and subject, text and world, public and private in this way, Annie Allen's bookishness calls to mind the cubist uncouplings of Black bodies as discrete, coherent entities in William H. Johnson's 1942 painting, Jitterbugs II. As we see here, dance, one of the supposedly natural talents of Black people, breaks the world apart into a delirious scramble of color, shape, and movement. More compellingly, Brooks's ploys with her books as front matter suggest a comparison with Charles Alston's 1940 painting, Tobacco Farmer. There is much to be said about this painting, especially how the farmer's earnestness is achieved through the use of color. Notice how the clean light blue of his coveralls and the warm brown tones of his skin radiate about him, and the collapse of depth of field. Look at how the land he tills butts right up against the farmer's back. The man and his scene of labor merge into one space. But let me draw your attention to the frame. Are the brown borders a window through which we see the farmer in relation to the landscape, or is he standing before an already finished painting, hanging on a wall? A circumstance which throws both his identity and his place in time and space into doubt. To see Tobacco Farmer as a painting about painting is to recognize its self-consciousness as a crafted object, one that pulls the viewer more deeply into the picture scene. Likewise, Brooks's honing of Annie Allen's material construction as a book object calls attention to the labor required by authors and readers to make literature function as both a signifying system and a social relation. A brief look at Annie Allen's table of contents makes this point strikingly clear. And this, here we have the table of contents to Annie Allen. And as you can see, we've got three subdivisions. How many of you have read Annie Allen, perhaps? It's okay if you haven't. Good, more summer reading. So, notes from the girl, childhood and the girlhood, the Anniad, the womanhood, divide Annie's life into these three arcs. It's basically a Bildungsroman in verse. It's basically like a biography of this character, Annie Allen, told in verse. What's striking about this organization of the table of contents, though, is that under each section or phase of Annie's life, childhood, girlhood, as you would expect, the Anniad, she falls in love with the soldier, he rejects her, she enters into a more mature sense of herself and the world, and then the womanhood, how she looks out on the world, knowing what she does because of her failed love. The poems that comprise each of those phases of her life are listed here. What's striking, these poems are listed by their first lines. The poems are listed by their first lines, not their titles. And there are no pages here either, right? We're used to pages in a table of contents. There's no pages, right? So bear that in mind as I think about what this means. So, for instance, the volume's first poem, titled, when you go inside the book, the title at the top of the poem is Birth in a Narrow Room, which describes Annie's birth, right? Here, in the table of contents, it appears as Weeps Out of Western Country Something New. And there's not a page number for you to go there, right? The next poem is titled The Parents, People Like Our Marriage, Maxie and Andrew. Here is listed as Clogged and Soft and Sloppy Eyes. No page number to tell you where to go. Obviously, this table doesn't work in the usual sense of its noun form. As this surface for writing, the table of contents is highly unstable. Instead, table functions as its verb form predicts. This list of contents suspends meaning-making rather than distilling or concentrating it. Forced to piece the poems and text together through sustained visual labor, the reader enters into a metonymic engagement with Annie Allen, relating the book's parts to the whole arc for the titular character's life story. Structuring our encounters of Annie Allen's dust jacket, frontispiece, and table of contents in this way, Brooks makes reading poetry a visual event. Indeed, with Annie Allen, a reader is not just reading, but seeing poetry. And not just seeing lines of words on the page, but seeing how those words and pages are made in relation to one another. In this way, Brooks's ploy with ekphrasis arguably demonstrates one legacy of the ancestral arts, to recall Elaine Locke's famous essay. Like the sculptural craft of African masks, Annie Allen's physical design enacts the lesson of discipline, of style, of technical control pushed to the limits of technical mastery. But what about the poems themselves? What makes them abstract? As I suggested at the start of my talk, the poems of Annie Allen positively revel in their verbal densities, none as much as the Anniad. However, to recall Brooks's term, I want to hone in on one word that recurs most frequently throughout this very long poem. In stanzas 1, 3, 5, 24, 26, 42, and 43, the reader is told to think, think is the word, of Annie as she thinks, waits for loves, regards herself in the mirror, and endures her lover's rejection. And we're told to think through a specific poetic habit of mind. Brooks issues these commands as apostrophes. Why structure the reader's relationship to the text in this way? Think is at once a remarkably banal but powerfully resonant word, since it's used so often to define the capacity that makes human beings the special creatures we are. Foregrounding it as she does in the Aeneid, Brooks recalls the long racialized history that shapes thinking's meaning, since thought was an activity Black people weren't supposed to be capable of. Thus, when readers are hailed to think by each apostrophe, a new relation between the reader and the poem's Black subject is set in motion. Consider this stanza from the poem's close. Think of tweaked and 24, fuchsias gone or gripped or gray, all hay-colored that was green, crouching low behind a screen, pockmarked, eyelight, and the sore eaglets of old pride and prey. Turning Annie's body into images of dead flowerings, the electric pink fuchsias gone gray, grass molting into brittle straw, the reader who thinks about sorrow as these metaphors suggest does not appropriate Annie's weakening as his own. Rather, the thinking reader regards Annie's position and plight as their own complex formations in space and time, a recognition of difference required of us by Brooks's pun on the word sore. Spelled to refer to injury, S-O-R-E, rather than to soar as in flight, S-O-A-R, the play of homonyms demands the reader's visual scrutiny to be known as such, since the referent for wound, sore, S-O-R-E, and the trope of freedom, S-O-A-R, are not one and the same word. To get this point, we have to do more than read these lines, and we can't hear that difference either. We have to see Brooks's language on the page to register the semantic difference. With our sight lines mirrored back to us so vividly, readers know our relation to Annie and the text precisely. We are not indigenous to her world. We must project ourselves into it. And once there, we must think about Annie's difference from us if we're to identify with her at all. Of course, the reader might not want to think about so hard about Brooks's poem, which Elaine Locke admitted he didn't want to do. Remember, he called Annie Allen's diction turgid and overanxious. And yet, precisely because the visual cacophony of Annie Allen's dust jacket and the Aeneid's apostrophes create such discrepant engagements in our encounters of the text and its paratexts, readers must come to terms with how challenging or easy we prefer poems about Black life worlds to be. Forced to examine our usual habits of reading Black poetry in such self-conscious ways, Annie Allen's readers engage in a politics of reciprocity, which demand that we no longer rely upon transparent racial unities or mythic wishes for transcendent wholeness to experience a Black text. Rather, in Annie Allen, knowledge claims get forged through the reader's self-conscious struggle to negotiate what it means to make meaning. And in 1949, in a segregated America, this race contract was no small or easy claim for Gwendolyn Brooks to make. However, to a growing cadre of literary and cultural historians, negotiating what it means to make meaning made African-American poetry too oblique, that's a term that crops up in this scholarship a lot, to serve any tangible, useful political good in African-Americans' lives during the 1940s and 50s. In these accounts, I refer here to the groundbreaking work of Bill Mullen, James Smethurst, Alan Wald, Stacey Morgan, Michael Denning, Penny Von Eschen, and Nikhil Singh, among others. The Cold War placed a big chill on the insurgent energies that characterized Black radicalism of the 1930s. As these scholars persuasively demonstrate, the economic ravages of the Great Depression and the spread of fascism into Africa, with Mussolini's invasion of Ethiopia in 1935, led African Americans to embrace a class-focused international critique of racism. This rise of Pan-African solidarity did not exclude the formation of cross-racial alliances, though, for as Bill Mullen points out, the Communist Party's popular front movement fostered an extraordinary rapprochement between African American and white members of the U.S. left around the debate and struggle for a new American Negro culture. Bolstered by these political coalitions and also funded by the patronage of the US federal government's public arts programs during the New Deal, it's important to recognize that it's the Communist Party left was an important kind of patron for black arts production during the 1930s and early 1940s, and so was the New Deal through the WPA, the Works Progress Administration arts programs. Social realism found artists and audiences eager for art to do something, namely sharpening the political consciousness to leverage social and political change on behalf of America's poor and working classes, as literary graphic arts historian Stacey Morgan sums up the era. So that the 1930s were a time of charged, kind of global outlooks on the parts of black writers and artists in cross-racial alliances, right? So that's the characterization of the 1930s. These scholars also agree that the post-World War II decades eclipsed these gains. Anti-communist repression drove anti-colonial activists into hiding or exile, domesticating the international perspective that galvanized black political and creative work during the 1930s. In US politics stateside, racism and capitalism gave birth to a weird twin. Segregation spurred black entrepreneurship in major northern cities. At the same time, the military-industrial complex paid African Americans higher wages for factory work in the wartime economy. Historians of the US black left conclude that this prosperity blunted anti-capitalist activism of the 1930s. So the rise of basically a black consumer class thwarted this kind of global, politicized solidarity network that was taking shape in the 1930s. Between the drive to purge foreign ideologies like communism from public discourse and the newfound relevance of consumerism as a lever of social power for blacks, liberalism's appeal to African Americans increased to all-time highs during the 1940s and 50s. And this turn, by the account of these historians, was epitomized by the rise of a new social type, the black bourgeoisie intellectual. Torn between, this is a quote from Bill Mullen, between Marxian or radical commitment and personal achievement, these weak-souled black folks abandoned the 1930s principles of collective struggle in one of three ways, according to historians of the black literary left: exile, covert political rebellion, or internal flight. According to these accounts, the embourgeoisement of African American cultural production and politics sounded the death knell for black art. That is, if we insist on delimiting black art to the realm of figural realism, as political satirist Ollie Harrington observes in this 1959 cartoon published in the Pittsburgh Courier. And here we kind of have the prototypic, you know, the beat guy. The beat, you know, got the beret, the beard. He looks like he'd live in Brooklyn right now, right? Do you watch Girls? No, okay. Anyway. You know, he's got the brogans and all this. And this figure is Bootsy, who is Harrington's kind of every black everyman, working class guy who kind of speaks truth to power, right? And so he's looking at this strange painting, the ear, the, you know, the bubbles here, the number seven, it's all kind of cryptic and abstract in the worst possible way, right? And so the caption reads, "No, it don't make no sense to me neither, Booty, but white folks just won't buy nothing if it makes sense." That was Harrington. To be sure, anti-communist purges and censorship drove African-American poets to veil their art behind non-figural forms. Arnold Rampersad suggests this was the exemplary case with Langston Hughes's 1951 collection, Montage of a Dream Deferred. And as Alan Wald rightfully laments, poet Frank Marshall Davis refused to write verse for 30 years after FBI and anti-miscegenation harassment drove him away from Chicago to Honolulu, Hawaii. Visual artists face censorious repression too. Elizabeth Catlett fled McCarthyite surveillance from Mexico City's Taller de Gráfica Popular, where she spent the rest of her working life. She died there, in fact, she never came back to the US. Working in exile, honing her craft at radical graphic arts and sculpture. And it's undeniably true that the lure of commercial success led some African American novelists to abandon black subjects in their work. The most famous being Frank Yerby, whose plantation romances set in the antebellum South and which featured the lives of the masters instead of the enslaved were perennial bestsellers throughout the post-war decades. And as a quick footnote to this, you know, Ralph Ellison, who wrote Invisible Man, you know, if we could only write one book, you know, that would be great. But he was so jealous of Yerby, because every year this guy was publishing a book that would sell hundreds of thousands of books. And in the published account of Ellison's correspondence with Albert Murray, they both are just pissed. They're mad that Yerby keeps selling so many books. We're smarter than that, but he keeps selling books. However, Abstraction served as more than a maroon hideout or a crossover cash out for African-American poets and painters. To read the late Amiri Baraka, then Leroy Jones's 1964 essay, Philistinism and the Negro Writer, Abstraction was to be a founding gesture of radical black politics. One way Negroes could force institutionalized dishonesty to crumble and its apologizers to break and run would be to turn crazy, to bring out a little American Dada, Ornette Coleman style, Baraka Jones declared. For painter collagist Romare Bearden, non-figural representation promised a special transformative catharsis. A painting's structure is exacting in its spiritual and intellectual demands, and as such, it unites such complexities as a sense of the past, as well as the total response of the painter to his craft, to himself, and to the life about him. The brilliant curmudgeon Russell Atkins bluntly assessed figural realism's limits for poetry as follows. Realism in the sense of a disposition to think, perceive, or act in light of things as they are is unprogressive, dull. And Gwendolyn Brooks endorsed a view like Atkins in her 1950 manifesto, Poets Who Were Negroes. Every Negro poet has something to say. Simply because he is a Negro, he cannot escape having important things to say. His mere body, for that matter, is an eloquence. His quiet walk down the street is a speech to the people, is a rebuke, a plea, a school. But no real artist is going to be content with offering raw materials. The Negro poet's most urgent duty at present is to polish his technique, his way of presenting his truths and beauties, that these may be more insinuating, more overwhelming. As these pronouncements make clear, African-American poets and painters of the post-World War II pre-Civil Rights Movement era turned to non-figural representation not to opt out of society and politics. Nor did their embrace of abstraction signal their seduction into false consciousness by the integrationist impulse, a term also used by the literary left's historians. On the contrary, abstraction, what Brooks calls here polished technique, allowed these poets and painters to insinuate profoundly public truths to the world in which they lived. After all, their historical moment was in deeper flux than the literary left critics acknowledge. The post-World War II years were flush with the mounting triumphs of integration. Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier in professional baseball in 1947. The Saturday Evening Post opened its pages to the likes of Zora Neale Hurston, Langston Hughes, and Walter White. And visual artists Jacob Lawrence, Romare Bearden, and Norman Lewis, who I'll talk about in a bit, joined major galleries in New York City. And yet, World War II and post-war life were marked by the brutalizing realities of segregation. The armed forces jumped Jim Crow until 1948. Black voting rights were null and void until 1965. African-American men, women, and children continued to be lynched. All the while that black art was being lionized, the venues where it was being exhibited and performed were closed off to the general black public's participation, and we know of the stories of artists themselves being shut out from the venues where they were performing, right? The famous stories of Louis Armstrong, Lena Horne, Dinah Washington having to enter the very halls where they performed by the back door. We know this to be true. In an era when the color line ruthlessly jeopardized the material lived experience of African Americans, abstraction's contestation of embodied representation charted new ground from which black poets and painters could address the world. So my argument here is that abstraction actually provides black artists and painters a way to contest segregation's delimiting of physical space in which black bodies could move. It gave them a way to imagine a different social ground to meet and address the world. James Baldwin conceived the threat and opportunity of this juncture best, quote, "The precise role of the artist is to illuminate that darkness, to blaze roads through that vast forest so that we will not, in all our doing, lose sight of our purpose, which is to make the world a more human dwelling place." In Baldwin's eloquent formulation, the particularities of black existence become paradigmatic of the human condition as such. That's the bid that abstraction is allowing black artists to make, that black experience is worldly, that black experience is universal, that we all have lessons to learn from it, right? Consequently, this appeal to a universalized identity for black artists as artists does not deny their racial identity nor remove them from the realm of politics. On the contrary, Baldwin's declaration places black artists in charge of witnessing the globe's most pressing threats. Two of them, the liberation of the death camps in Nazi Germany and the dropping of the atomic bomb in Japan, prove that the racialized logics of imperialist statecraft and social dominance operated on scales that African Americans had to confront. And these events unnerved, but also galvanized, black writers and painters profoundly. As Margaret Walker worried in her essay, New Poets, from 1950, racial prejudice is a weapon that is as dangerous as the atomic bomb. It threatens to annihilate peace and culture in the Western world. For Walker, poetic innovation, what she called technical advances, offered one way to break racism's molds of hegemony as formal experimentation internationalized her term. So abstraction internationalized African-American poetry by bringing it into contact with other cultural traditions. Elaine Locke nursed these A-bomb blues too, fretting whether the mid-century decade shall witness the downfall of Western civilization or the dawn of newly integrated cultures. And like Locke, painter Beaufort Delaney felt besieged by the terribly disordered world we've inherited, exploring the realm of non-figural painting as its own bulwark against fascism's many death guises and threats. In this untitled work, Delaney summoned Locke's dawn by turning to yellow, the color that permeates his late 1950s work, to lift us into a deathless world. Negating the negation that racism reified and which atomic power threatened to fetishize, abstraction affirmed African-American painting and poetry's commitment to envisioning a just social world by engaging with it. The case I'm making for African-American poetry and painting social formalism, to borrow literary theorist Dorothy Hale's phrase, draws upon Daniel Belgrad's persuasive study of mid-20th century experimental art and the culture of spontaneity. The counter-art histories of abstract expressionism forwarded by Ann Gibson, Kavanagh Mercer, and Alexander Nimerov more thickly inform my argument because their definitions of abstraction encompass a wider range of art practices and objects, including those that comprise African-American poetry and painting during the 1940s and 50s. For Gibson, abstract expressionism's formal and cultural histories have excluded women and people of color from the genre's ranks because critics fixate on taxonomizing abstraction's visual style. Thus, canvases must be so large, brushstrokes produce certain ways, paint, never photographs or sculpture, mix and apply to specific kinds of surfaces. How, though, are we to categorize non-figural art that isn't as big or doesn't look like a Pollock, de Kooning, Motherwell, or Rothko canvas? Is that work not abstract? And what to make of the fact that even the canonical abstract expressionists returned to the repressed called figuration? They all went back to some figure of some sort, something that looks like something we know, because no turn is ever unbroken or complete. Does that work not rate as abstract either? Gibson argues that abstraction's fullest range of visual possibility can be conceived if we stress the genre's epistemological claims as much as we labor to index its visual codes and style. That is, what does an abstract work do to its viewer, and how does the artwork produce those effects? How do we know what we know? How do we feel what we feel when we see a work of art? That's where we can talk about something being abstract or not. That's her claim. Alexander Nimerov and Kavanagh Mercer answer these questions from two angles. First, they contend that a painting need not be non-figural to produce abstraction's signature effect of discrepancy, an allowance of the odd and alien amid an otherwise not secure aesthetic mix. So something that's off, something that's different. It can look like a square or a bird, but there might be something off in that depiction of a bird that makes you start to think. And for them, that's where abstraction becomes a possibility, right? That is how artworks realign form and meaning, what Mercer calls the discrepant engagement That determines whether we can call a work abstract or not. Second, Nemirov and Mercer insist that abstraction is by definition socially informed rather than purified by history the way Clement Greenberg and the other major definers of abstract expressionism in the 1940s and 50s insisted that abstraction was about pushing history and society out of the frame of the picture. For Nemirov and Mercer, it's about after 1940, which is to follow Adorno, after Auschwitz, nothing is without the social. Nothing we imagine is without some reference to the world in it. Nothing we look at is not about loss or change. Understood this way, abstraction's visual point is not to make sense of the world, but to scramble it into a more perfect confusion, in Nemirov's words. Or in Mercer's, abstraction's defining quality lies in its openness. If we bear those definitions in mind, then we can go back to a work like Gwendolyn Brooks's Annie Allen and talk about it as abstract. Because its rhetorics, the way it opens up, that book opens up and then draws our attention to its odd or discrepant look as a book, invites different kinds of thoughts. Likewise, Brooks's use of apostrophe in the Aeneid produces abstraction's signature discrepancy. Thinking, right, that word think that appears so many times in that poem, scrambles the world into a more perfect confusion, precisely because the apostrophes fulfill the prophecy Annie Allen's title foretells. Annie's life, a black woman's life, moreover, a working class black woman's life, comes to symbolize the life course of any and all of its readers as the character's name puns, right? Annie Allen, Annie, all. And in 1949, in a segregated America, this was no small or easy truth for Brooks to insinuate through her book's form. Oh, I wish it was a little darker so you could see this. Can you see that clearly? Maybe, kind of, sort of? Yeah. It's beautiful, trust me. In 1946, in a segregated America, painter Norman Lewis completed Metropolitan Crowd. This is a visually arresting work precisely because as we marvel at the wondrous slashes of color, red, orange, white, blue, yellow, green, and blends of these, we realize that there are no human bodies in this crowd. Instead, we're looking at traces of human presence and movement. Here we see contact, collision, intersection, interaction. We see a geometry of hope in which the edges and surface of the painting's black background give rise to unfettered human action and contact. In the space of blackness, human mobility, human autonomy, human intimacy, and human interdependence not only insist upon being seen, these four freedoms demand visibility. To see the world this way, Lewis had to redefine his relationship to figural painting. Before the 1940s, he painted proletarian life studies like Yellow Hat, the painting here. Calling upon the ample corporeal shapes and vivid color palette of Mexican muralist Diego Rivera, Lewis's early work focused on street scenes and domestic interiors, depicting the daily rituals and hardships of Harlem's black working class. Made in 1936, Yellow Hat depicts a black woman, probably a maid, perhaps a faithful churchgoer, given her white dress, sitting dejectedly. Her body appears burdened by both fatigue and the irony of her vividly colored hat. That accessory graces her head but buries her face from view. It's a halo that doesn't portend good tidings to come. Lewis's commitment to painting working class subjects was forged in the artistic collectives he belonged to in the 1930s. A member of Augusta Savage's Uptown Art Laboratory, Lewis also taught at the WPA's Harlem Community Arts Center when it opened in 1933. But it was in Charles Alston's 306 group, whose members included painters Romare Bearden, Jacob Lawrence, and John Wilson, and writers Ralph Ellison, Richard Wright, County Cullen, and Claude McKay, where Lewis met Ad Reinhardt, who then introduced him to New York's downtown painting scene. And Ad Reinhardt is a major abstract expressionist painter. Lewis's friendship with Reinhardt, Adolph Gottlieb, Bartlett Newman, Mark Toby, Mark Rothko, and Jackson Pollock, together with his solo exhibitions at the Marion Willard Gallery, brought Lewis into the fold of Studio 35, the collective that defined abstract expressionism as an aesthetic movement and its three-day summit in 1950. And what's striking, why you should never, I shouldn't say this because I'm going to show you some really cool photographs at the end, but photographs, you know, they frame history for us. They don't tell history for us. And the photographs that we have of that tremendous meeting at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, don't include Lewis in them, though he was there. But it was the work of Metropolitan Crowd that put him on the map. And this is Lewis. Moving between these two worlds, uptown and downtown, figural realism and abstraction, Lewis's painting aesthetic evolved so completely that the human figure and social milieu that were discernible in proletarian paintings like Yellow Hat become difficult to perceive in the years to follow. This melange of long hatches, ovals, and lines that look like so many whole, half, and quarter notes are, in fact, a pianist, bassist, and drummer. This painting depicts Lewis's idea in 1948 of jazz musicians, the title of the painting, in action. And this 1954 work is, according to its title, a Harlem courtyard. Canonical accounts of abstract expressionist painting contend that its afigural rhetorics or speechlessness stem from the era's embrace of the unconscious and spontaneity as resources for representation. Adolf Gottlieb's pictographs, Jackson Pollock's drip paintings, and Mark Rothko's color field blocks exemplify these claims. As Harlem Courtyard suggests, what distinguished Lewis from the contemporaries to whom he was compared, Pollock, Ed Reinhardt, and Mark Toby, is the conscious stylization of his picture fields, as one reviewer characterized Lewis's work in 1949. The same year, Gwendolyn Brooks's editor complained that Annie Allen was too intellectual, too modern, right? While it's debatable whether Lewis's paintings are unspontaneous, it's incontestable that he felt self-conscious about the racialized pressures placed upon him to produce figural art. For many years, I struggled single-mindedly to express social conflict through my paintings. However, gradually I came to realize that certain things are true. The development of one's aesthetic ability suffers by such emphasis. The content of truly creative work must be inherently aesthetic, or the work becomes merely another form of illustration. Therefore, the goal of the artist must be aesthetic development, and in a universal sense, to make in his own way some contribution to culture. Further, I realize that my own greatest effectiveness would not come by painting racial difficulties, but by excelling as an artist, first of all. In a statement like this, Lewis's aspirations for achieving social equality through artistic excellence sound like a throwback to the cultural nationalism of Alain Locke, W.B. Du Bois, and James Weldon Johnson from the Harlem Renaissance. However, in the 1940s and 1950s, this valorization of Negro self-expression placed Lewis collusively close to post-war liberalism's cult of individualism, which stressed the achievements of lone Black Americans as examples of American democracy over and against the image of group advancement, going back to that 1930s collective solidarity, international sense of Black politics, 1930s, 40s and 50s, the lone individual culture hero, right? Footnote, and one thing that I'm trying to do in this project of mine is to restore the collective cohort generational moment of these artists, that they experienced each other as a group. They knew each other. They talked to each other. They worked with each other. They didn't like each other sometimes. They were jealous of each other, but they were aware of each other. And in our own writings of that history, in our own, the way we frame it, eludes that from view, right? And so when we get images like this of Lewis without any company, that's important, right? Alone. Right? This picture does not tell us that he knew Ad Reinhardt. It doesn't tell us that he knew Romare Bearden either, who is a Black painter, right? But here he strikes the perfect pose of un bourgeoisement, right? The prosperous race man in a gray flannel suit. However, when Lewis wrote the statement that I just quoted before for his Guggenheim Fellowship in 1949, that's where I got that from, he may have well have been thinking about C. Wright Mills' 1944 essay, The Powerless People, The Role of the Intellectual in Society, in which Mills argued, the independent artist and intellectual are among the few remaining personalities equipped to resist and to fight the stereotypes and consequent death of genuinely living things. Fresh perception now involves the capacity to continually unmask and to smash the stereotypes of vision and intellect with which modern communications swamp us. Then again, writing in 1964, the late Amiri Baraka Leroy Jones may have had Norman Lewis's paintings in mind when he declared, "It has become absolutely valuable for the black man to realize that he exists and his experience is as valid as any other. My own direction is always towards this spirit, which is the only thing I admit as being real. I say, where am I? Who am I? What's happening? Who are all these others? And I relate it to me." Baraka's and Lewis's insistence on reciprocity as the ground of individual experience and the contingent construction of personal identity, or that is, the assertion of the fundamental sociability of individual subjectivity, art making and meaning making alike. So it's not about being this atomized individual off in your little corner making your art. It's about trusting your vision enough to reach out to the world and to want to connect with it on other terms, right? That's the energy that suffuses metropolitan crowds' clash of colors. Thus, when we encounter Lewis's stated desire to contribute to culture in a universal sense, we shouldn't construe that claim as a conformist repudiation of either the social or of politics, because the residuum of the figural in his art, the crowd and the line traces of metropolitan crowd, the specters of segregation and the Holocaust and the barbed lines of crosses that mark his 1954 work Limits, which you're seeing here, or the letter-like human bodies that mass together in Parade, this is from 1961, reveal Lewis's assertion of the right to opacity, which, as Edouard Glissant argues in The Poetics of Relation, founds the enabling condition of black art production. Unlike transparency and mimesis, aesthetic ideals which hold that art or social exchange in its broadest sense should be directly accessible or exactly commensurate with lived material experience, opacity honors and preserves difference. It is that which cannot be reduced, Glissant declares. Alterity's endurance ensures that opacity brings peoples and ideas into contact, or as he phrases it, into participation and confluence, because, to quote Glissant, "the thought of opacity distracts me from absolute truths whose guardian I might believe myself to be. Far from cornering me with futility and inactivity, by making me sensitive to the limits of every method, it relativizes every possibility of action within me. Whether this consists of spreading overarching general ideas or hanging on to the concrete, the laws of facts, the precisions of details, or sacrificing some apparently less important thing in the name of efficacy, the thought of opacity saves me from unequivocal courses and irreversible choices." Understood through Glissant's formulation, what might first appear to be isolationist on Lewis's part instead posits a powerful contestation of figural realism's claims to ideological power. Paradoxically, the opacities that characterize Lewis's canvases visualize the tensions between social equality and individual liberty, autonomous expression and collective memory, political containment and intellectual freedom, publicity and privacy. Seen this way, Lewis's paintings, like the book object and poems of Annie Allen, challenge rather than recapitulate what liberal humanism symbolized and meant during the post-war decades. And in 1949, in a segregated America, this was a significant stand for Norman Lewis to take. I'm at the end here. Thinking our way into Annie Allen and Norman Lewis's paintings, we encounter how African-American poetry and painting during the 1940s and 50s turned abstraction into a profoundly social practice. However, because the formal opacities of these works confound our conventional criteria for Negro art, to recall Du Bois's prophetic and prescriptive manifesto from 1926, we have yet to come to terms with the interpretive challenges this canon requires us to meet. But as this photograph of Gwendolyn Brooks reading the draft manuscript in Annie Allen in Chicago shortly before its release suggests, in 1949, in a segregated America, black reading publics wanted to engage with the demands her poems required of them. And likewise, these mass market editions of Invisible Man, I love this, The Street, and Giovanni's Room, I collect these things. And I can say more about them, they're really wonderful books. But the point I want to make here about them is that these are really hard books. The novels themselves are really formally, really formally difficult. But they're published here in these mass marketed, pulped up, tarted up editions, right? And they sold by the hundreds of thousands. Anne Petrie's The Street sold on average between 1948 and 65, the records we have on hand, around 400,000 copies a year. Yeah, yeah. Invisible Man sold around 600,000 copies a year from 1952 to 65. People wanted to read this stuff, and it's hard, right? So difficult literature was popular in the 1940s and 50s. I'd like to think that Alain Locke would have regarded this turn to abstraction by Brooks and Lewis's generation as the kind of self-criticism he called for in 1950 that would break the taboos, his term, that Locke still felt sealed greatly original and moving revelations about Negro life and experience. However, because it's always easier to write history with the privilege of hindsight, our challenge is to track and map abstraction's constellation as capaciously as possible, not to fix its fields and periods of cultural production into set unyielding positions, but rather to chart how its clusters orbited in relation to one another and their historical moment and towards ours as well. For in an age of epistemological absolutism and political violence like our own, we have much to learn from this generation of Black writing and painting, given how prophetic the closing lines of Annie Allen proved to be. Rise, let us combine. There are no magic or elves or timely godmothers to guide us. We are lost, must wizard a track through our own screaming weed. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jackie, for your presentation. I thought it was just fabulous. I have a question about some of the language that you were using in your conclusion. You said constellation. You said circulation. And then earlier on in your presentation, you mentioned Frank Marshall Davis going into exile to Honolulu. You mentioned Richard Wright publishing The Outsider in Paris in 1953. And these seem like constellations, circulations. And so I'd like to ask you to talk about the way that constellation and circulation mm-hmm. and the tradition of exile, mm-hmm. Or the option of geographical exile at this point, corresponds to your interest in Chicago as a hub.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's a good question. I think I hear that question in relationship to the kind of offhand footnote I offered about the photograph of Lewis and how that image, as beautiful and striking as it is, I mean, it's a really handsome image of him as an art maker, it seems to me, isolates him and doesn't reveal the constellation of friendships and networks that he was a part of. And I think that that's part of the reason why Chicago proves to become such a hub, an important hub for this generation, for this era, because Chicago was able to lay a kind of cultural infrastructure, or set a cultural infrastructure into place that allowed for those migrations to be mapped and to be made legible. What do I mean by that? I mean that Chicago becomes the hub of Black print modernity by the mid-20th century, because you have Johnson Publications putting out Ebony and Jet, which has a national circulation and a global circulation. I was just reading a really fabulous essay about the tradition of panegyric, kind of praise photography in Nigerian photo magazines from the late 60s into the present day. And it is absolutely clear that those magazines in Nigeria are taking their visual cues from Ebony, completely clear. Not only in their visual look, but the editor statements, they were reading Ebony and Jet, right? So Ebony and Jet are circulating not only around the US, but around the globe. So that's coming out of Chicago. The Chicago Defender famously You know, it is the most important African-American newspaper of the 20th century precisely because of the ways in which that newspaper out of Chicago radiated around the U.S., and not just the U.S., again, around the globe, right? That's the force of Penny Von Eschen's argument, tracing the network of black diaspora intellectuals during the 1930s, who were waging in print this critique of anti-colonial, in the Defender became an important site where critics of colonial regimes in Africa were able to have their own voice in a black print medium, and they were meeting up in the Chicago paper. And so it's by way, and this is coming out of Chicago, and there's a real industry around the Defender and Johnson Publications, and there are numerous little magazines and little newspapers that are propping this up as well, that are black owned, black managed, black staffed, in large part. So I think that this idea of constellation and circulation becomes possible out of Chicago precisely because it has the technology to make those flows of ideas and bodies visible and to report on them, right? So that not just a black readership can see them, but anybody who wanted to read The Defender or Ebony or Jet could see this. And I think it had a different kind of aspiration precisely because it was not afraid of reaching out to the masses in ways that, say, The Crisis delimited its reach. And I'm not criticizing that. I'm just saying that the Crisis had a, you know, the NAACP's magazine had a specific kind of political commitment and agenda and published its magazine, which did so much literary work. We know this from the Harlem Renaissance, but it wasn't seeking to build a mass readership in the way that The Defender did, or Ebony, precisely because both of those publications explicitly acknowledged and fostered its commercial underpinnings. Do you see what I'm saying? So that's a really helpful question, though, because it's helping me to articulate for myself what's at stake in describing how migration matters to Chicago's contribution to this literary moment. It's not simply, what your question is helping me see is this, it's not simply about, you know, the flow of black bodies to Chicago, and out of all these millions of black people who wind up in Chicago, there's this creative class that emerges of brilliant black poets and painters who become famous and do their work. That does happen, but what you're getting at is how the infrastructure, the cultural infrastructure, the print culture infrastructure allows that for a migration of ideas in addition to bodies to flow beyond Chicago. Which is why then the romance of Wright leaving doesn't become the disabling fiction that it is. Because once Richard Wright decides to leave Chicago for New York and then Paris, it's like, well, I guess it all shuts down. And actually some critics have said that. I mean, it drives me crazy. And but the activity still goes on. That's why Gwendolyn Brooks doesn't have to leave so dramatically and so theatrically. She stays in Chicago. She travels around, but you know, Chicago is her home, but the way in which her ideas circulate out because of her relationship first to Harper's and then her relationship to Third World Press, right, and Broadside Press because of the Midwestern network of print culture is important. Probably the very best, I'm thinking out loud here, I'm sorry, but this is really a work in progress, okay? So, and this is a great question. The very best account for that, we'd have to take it back to DeVere and Baldwin, Chicago's New Negroes, right? Where he traces how from the 1890s to the 1920s, because of the great migration's flow of black bodies to Chicago, you could have the rise of an entrepreneurial class. And this is what doesn't take hold in Harlem. This is what does not take hold in Harlem. And it's one of the things that makes the Harlem Renaissance different from the Chicago Renaissance. Is that in Chicago, black entrepreneurs commit to building black institutions that are for profit, that want to make money, of legal and illegal sorts. So gambling was, you know, running the numbers was really, really important in Chicago, also in New York. But the Chicago money got funneled into more traditional cultural forms, so that Mushmouth Johnson, who ran the numbers rackets in Chicago, wound up funding Oscar De Priest's 1928 bid for the U.S. Congress. And this is how the black political machine in Chicago starts to find its footing with De Priest's victory. Okay? And it's gambling money that seeds that. Nothing comparable, you know, black New York, black Harlem doesn't crack into New York City's electoral politics in quite the same way. Still hasn't, right? But that happens in Chicago, and that's the difference. That's the difference. And the print culture operatives make that legible. So that's how the constellation and circulation takes a particular kind of shape because of Chicago. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thanks.
Okay, because that helps me. So if it makes sense to you, then it's okay, good. Thank you. Thanks. Yeah. I didn't recognize you with your hat.
Non-teaching day, sorry.
Okay, no. That's a good outfit.
Well, thank you. Shucks. And now, the more I listen to you talk, the more I think I need to go to Chicago this summer, but that's a whole separate thing. I'm going to do what academics do and say, okay, how does your hobby horse relate to my hobby horse? Mm-hmm. But it's been well established that in the late 40s and the 50s, CIA, Congress for Cultural Freedom, funded a lot of the abstract expressionists in New York. Francis Saunders, Greg Barnheisel, they've done a great job of getting that out there. And I'm curious if you have run into that as studying African-American abstract expressionists and their art, to see if it too was on the receiving end of such funding in order to combat mm-hmm. Soviet social realism, yes. And if so, how that might complicate some of the ideas that this kind of abstractionism allows them to push back against segregation, push back against some of these kind of controlling, domineering political narratives.
Yeah, that's a good question. I know Bearden and Lewis's kind of canon of work and the archive that's behind them best. So that's to say this is limited to an N of two. This is where segregation becomes an odd blessing. I don't recall them ever writing or talking about being included in those circuits. And so the ways in which they were participating in those vocabularies and you know, in conversation with the main players who were receiving that kind of, you know, institutional support from the CIA, being a part of those showings and so forth, they were a part of those conversations but not included in those exhibitions. So that's not to say that they weren't, and I should read that from the other side, because maybe the CIA, those fronts, tried to contact them and they refused. I don't know. But my first response is that, based on their own writings, they weren't invited in. And to the extent that black artists, I don't want to say this, that, and this is to put pressure on a claim I make at the start of the paper, that I think it's not about, you know, by thinking in medium-specific terms, I think we need to go drill really deep into that, right? Because we know that those kinds of programs existed for jazz musicians, right? And Penny Von Esch and Satchmo Blows Up the World gives us that view, right? I don't think we know as much about how that plays out with black abstract expressionist painters, or of African-American or black writers, generally speaking, with the kind of degree of sophistication that we have about music practice. So my answer would be, I ought to research that from both ends of it, right? Which is to say, I've read what I can of Lewis and Bearden's papers, not seen any reference to it, but I ought to see if the CIA, you know, if those organizations try to contact them, were they ever discussed, right? And maybe were they rejected? I don't know. But that's a good question. That's a good question, yeah.
Because it's an interesting time for African-American artists, right? Because on the one hand, there's tons of money pouring out of the CIA and from the feds in order to boost up the idea of a unique American cultural expression. At the same time, those who were, you know, disobedient or unruly, kind of a la Paul Robeson and others, then were getting pressure on the other side by the same people who were trying to fund other artists at the time. So, so it's a...
I absolutely see your point and agree with it. It makes me think about, what do I want to say in response to that? That doing more archival work I would need to do. So if you need to go to Chicago, I need to find out where those archives are and read them. So I'm serious. I'm going to get that from you. But that's also to say, though, that just because someone is present in that network doesn't mean that they're not. We have to be careful to define the terms by which they engage in that practice, right? Because oftentimes for artists, and Robin Kelly's new book, Africa Speaks, America Answers, which is really fascinating history of the jazz cultural exchanges from out of Brooklyn to Ghana in the late 50s and 60s, and how those musical exchanges, often fostered by State Department programs, encouraged all kinds of experimentation, especially on African musicians' side, and American, how that exchange worked. And the musicians were very clear, hey, that's a gig. You know, that's it. The State Department wants me there, and they're going to pay my way, and I get to play with these people over there, and we get to have these conversations. Yeah, I'm there. I'll sign up, but that doesn't mean I buy into the program, right? And we have to think about the ways in which, and being there doesn't necessarily mean resistance, right? For so many of the musicians that he profiles in that study, participating in those State Department programs is about using the government money to have an artistic, spiritual encounter that they wanted for themselves. It had nothing to do necessarily with some larger political project at home. And so if we find black writers and artists in the midst of these networks, it doesn't necessarily mean that they've been co-opted into whatever the project is. And I'm saying that, like, thinking out loud to myself, because it's as much as anything, because it's so difficult to get to make a living as an artist. And I think one thing that defines this cohort of writers as a cohort for me, the 40s and 50s generation, is that they are self-willed to make their way in the world by their writing. Like, that's their day job. That's the main gig. They're not doing anything else. You know, Arnold Roberts said, you know, that's his case for Hughes. What makes Hughes the modern poet is it's almost an argument about the office of authorship, right? Because Hughes had resolved to make his living solely by his pen. But if you're going to make that choice and you're going to feed yourself by your art, then where you place yourself to get that support might, how we define what's political about that might need to be malleable, right? And I think what's challenging about the 1940s and 1950s generation is that they seem to put craft first. And politics follows form. And as critics, as scholars, at least for the African-American canon, it seems that we're uneasy with that, that choice. And we don't quite know what to make of it because it's not resistance by its ordinary name. So that if we find, for instance, there's a footnote in Nikhil Singh's Black as a Country where he does mention James Baldwin's alliance with one of the groups you name. Yeah. And pretty much all that calls him a CIA dupe. It's a pretty stern footnote. But I'm not sure that those are the terms that Baldwin understood his place there if he was making his living as a writer. So I'm thinking out loud. That's a really fantastic question. Again, based on the two artists that I know, I think these are where the ironies of segregation crop into this. They were excluded. Yeah.